Hey everyone, this lesson is on Tinea Corporis, also known as ringworm. So in this lesson, we're going to talk about what this condition is. We're also going to talk about what causes this condition. We'll also talk about some risk factors, signs and symptoms, how we can diagnose it, and how we can treat it. So Tinea Corporis, or ringworm, is a superficial skin infection caused by fungi known as dermatophytes. So it is a fungal skin infection. And it is a relatively common condition that occurs worldwide. And it is an infection involving the neck, the trunk, the arms, or the legs, as opposed to other areas of the body like the feet or the groin, which are different fungal skin infections we talk about in other lessons. And Tinea corporis, or ringworm, is actually the most common dermatophyte infection in children. So what are some of the causative organisms? We know that they are fungi, but what type of fungi? So they are dermatophytes, like trichophyton rubrum. And trichophyton rubrum is actually the most common species of dermatophyte fungi that causes Tinea corporis, or ringworm. We can also see other trichophyton species causing this condition as well, including trichophyton mentigrophytes and trichophyton tonsurans. And other dermatophytes can also cause this, like the microsporum species as well. And we see microsporum canis coming from cats and dogs. So cats and dogs that have microsporum canis can actually pass this along to humans, causing a Tinea corporis, or ringworm, infection as well. How is this condition transmitted, and what are some of the risk factors? So the transmission of Tinea corporis involves direct skin contact. So this can either be through a direct skin-to-skin contact with an affected human, or it could be from an animal, or it could be from the sand or soil. So if there's any fungi in the sand or the soil and you were to step on it, or you were to contact your skin with that affected sand or soil, you could essentially pick this fungi up and lead to an infection. And you could also have direct skin contact with fomites. So fomites are actually indirect objects like furniture. So if someone had Tinea corporis fungal skin infection and they were to touch a table, for instance, and you came along and touched that table shortly after, you could technically pick up that fungi. And there are some other infected sites as well. You can get it from auto infection. So if you had a part of your body that had another type of infection, generally speaking, the scalp, so Tinea capitis, if you have a Tinea capitis infection, you could spread that Tinea capitis fungi to other parts of your body. What are some of the risk factors? So some of the risk factors for actually getting Tinea corporis are the following: being in high humidity in warm or hot environments, wearing tight-fit clothing. So tight-fitting clothes, wearing them for a long period of time, can increase your risk for getting this condition. You can also see this being common in children and individuals who are older. And we can also see it in immunosuppressed patients. There is also a genetic predisposition to fungal infections in general, including Tinea corporis. Individuals with decreased beta defensins, or a decreased defensin beta 4, have been shown to be more susceptible to getting Tinea infections. We can also see it with individuals who have systemic disease, like diabetes and lymphoma. These are also associated with the immunosuppression. These conditions can cause immunocompromise and increase your risk for getting Tinea corporis. So what does Tinea corporis look like? So here is Tinea corporis. As you can see, it is a circular or oval-shaped skin lesion, and it occurs on most body surfaces like the trunk, the arms, the neck, the legs, except for the scalp, the hands, the feet, and the groin. If a fungal infection affects these areas of the body, they are different types of fungal skin infections. We talk about these in other lessons. Tinea corporis presents as erythematous and pruritic, so it's itchy. It has an itchy sensation to it. And as I mentioned before, it's circular and oval in shape. And you can see here it's strongly or clearly demarcated. So demarcated means that you can clearly see the border from the lesion to normal skin. There is a very distinct separation. And it is a scaling lesion, and it can either be a patch or a plaque. So it can either be flat or it can be slightly raised. And it spreads centrifugally, which means it spreads in all directions outward. And as it advances, as it spreads outward with an advancing border, the center of it begins to clear. And we'll show you what an image of that looks like here in a moment. Here's another look to Tinea corporis. So it might look like this, but it might look like this. So this is an alternate or a variant of the clinical presentation. So this, as you can see, is very raised, and the border is sharply raised with almost papular edges to it. Here's another image of Tinea corporis, and as you can see here, the outer advancing border is still quite erythematous, but there's a central clearing. That's what that central clearing is. And there is also something called Tinea corporis gladiatorum. Tinea corporis gladiatorum, you can think of it as a subset of Tinea corporis. It is Tinea corporis, but it is Tinea corporis caused in a certain way. And Tinea corporis gladiatorum is often caused by trichophyton tonsurans, as opposed to trichophyton rubrum, which is the most common cause. And it is Tinea corporis gladiatorum because it is more often found in athletes. And we can think of it as it's more often found in gladiators. That's where that word gladiatorum comes from. So it's actually transmitted by extensive direct contact with other infected individuals. You can see this in contact sports like football or wrestling. So again, Tinea corporis occurs on many different body surfaces except for the scalp, hands, feet, and groin. It is circular or oval in shape, and it is erythematous and pruritic, so it's itchy. And it has a scaling look to it, and oftentimes is very well demarcated, spreads out centrifugally, and it also oftentimes has central clearing. And then there's this odd presentation where there could be sharp raised edges that are papular. And there's also this other term you might hear, Tinea corporis gladiatorum, that occurs in athletes or what we call gladiators, that is transmitted by extensive direct contact with other infected individuals, and oftentimes it's caused by trichophyton tonsurans. And there's also another clinical variant to Tinea corporis, and that is known as Majocchi's granuloma. Sorry for the pronunciation. So Majocchi's granuloma is actually Tinea corporis that has gone a little bit wonky. So it's actually where the dermatophyte extends down along a hair follicle. It causes somewhat of a folliculitis to invade deeper skin structures. And what we do find is that small cuts can predispose to this condition, especially shaving. And it presents as papules, nodules, plaques, or pustules. So you can see a pustule here. Here is another look to this condition. You can see that there's some papules here. And here's another way that this condition might look. And this can actually lead to an abscess. As the dermatophyte extends down into deeper skin structures, it can actually cause an abscess to form. And this condition is more likely to occur in males. So it is Tinea corporis that has gone a bit wonky. It has essentially extended and invaded down along a hair follicle into deeper skin structures, causing this altered clinical presentation. How do we diagnose and how do we treat Tinea corporis? So the diagnosis of this condition involves oftentimes clinical reasoning or clinical diagnosis. In order to definitively say that this is Tinea corporis, we can do a potassium hydroxide wet mount, so a KOH prep or KOH wet mount. So what we do is we use a KOH wet mount and we look at skin scrapings from a skin lesion. And if we visualize segmented hyphae, like shown in this image here, that is the diagnosis of a tinea infection. So how do we treat this condition? A lot of times we want to try to modify the risk factors first. So we talked about all those risk factors before. So we want to try to modify those. And then we can use topical antifungals. So you can think of the azoles. So a lot of times that's the first line, but you could use naphtyphene, butenophene, and toll naphtate. And we oftentimes have to use these topical antifungals once to twice a day for 1 to 3 weeks. And important here is that nystatin is not effective for Tinea corporis. And if the topical antifungal is not effective, we might have to move on to oral antifungals like terbinafine or itraconazole. So again, to diagnose this condition, it is often a clinical diagnosis. We see the skin lesion and we look at risk factors and we determine that this is a tinea skin infection. Or we could do a KOH wet mount and visualize segmented hyphae. Treatment involves modifying risk factors. It's important to modify what might be causing this in the first place. So it could be tight-fitting clothing. And then we can use topical antifungals like the azoles, and we treat for a few weeks. And if that's not effective, we use oral antifungals. For more information on fungal skin infections, please check out my overview of fungal skin infections or my other lessons on athlete's foot or jock itch for more information. And if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. Consider subscribing to the channel. And thank you so much for watching. I hope to see you next time.